It's December today, December 21st. The month is running very, very fast, less than a month before the end of the year, and also less than a month before we vote for the presidential elections. So a lot of things are coming up. Christmas on Friday, then 5 days later, the end of the year, and we shall be in 2021. Whoever knew that it will go that fast? But we thank God for his goodness. We thank God that he has kept us, he has protected us, he has healed us from all kinds of sicknesses. And so we continue to look forward to the next year, believing that it's going to be a great year, because all the years are the years, we call them the year of our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's going to be a great year, 2021. I know a lot of good things are going to happen to the children of God, to those who do not fear the name of the Lord. I don't know what will happen to them, but I choose to hide under the name of the Lord, 2021. So I do have faith that it's going to be a great, great year. So as you've heard, we prepared two services on Christmas, one starting at 8, and another one starting at 8, ending at 10, and another starting immediately and ending at noon, so we can all go home and be with our families. It looks like a lot of people, even with all the warnings going around that please don't travel, a lot of people are traveling up country. I hope some people stay so we can have our two services. And then on 31st, we shall have one service in the evening. Because of the curfew and everything going on, we shall start at 4. I think 31st will be a public holiday, so we should have people at home. So we'll come around 4 and be done by 7. And then the following day, which will be the first of the year, we shall have just one service, for a Thanksgiving service. And we shall give people time, families time, to testify of God's goodness and be thankful to God. Amen. Well, just a reminder, a recap from yesterday's message that I was preaching about the greatness of God. I've come to understand from my years of walking with God that faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. And sometimes you got to repeat something more than once for that to register home, and so people don't forget. And sometimes for faith does not come the first time, does not come the third time. So you got to keep hearing the same word of the word, all the word of God, for your faith to develop. For without faith, it is impossible to please God, the Bible says. So we need faith. And it's very, very hard to believe someone that you do not know about their strength, their character, their ability, their capacity to do anything. Last week, I was around church, and one of my spiritual daughters came and said, "Papa, I'm going to buy you a Land Cruiser V8. And she just sat her senior 6. So I said, "My daughter, are you rich already? Do you have the money?" I said, "No, that's one of my dreams. It's my desire that someday when I have the money, I'm going to make money and I'll have enough. And I want to buy you one of the biggest cars on the market." And I don't want to be a Thomas, known to doubt. I believe and I pray that the Lord will give her the money so she can fulfill her desire. But you know, it's hard to believe when you know someone that they can't even buy themselves a phone or something small. And they say, "I'm going to do you to do for you this big thing. You kind of like, okay, maybe someday. You move in doubt. You don't have a lot of faith. Why? Because of the person, because of their ability at the moment. And so I told my spiritual daughter that, you know what, I am so glad that you have that idea, but I'm very sure by the time you think of buying me a car, you'll be married. So when you meet your husband, you might need to introduce them the idea that you really need to buy your papa a big car, a V8. And by then, it may not be a V8, it might be something very different, but the equivalent of a V8 then. So, but her ability now cannot really generate me faith to believe that she's able to do it. But I believe someday she will. But when it comes to believing God, our faith is totally dependent on who he is, his greatness, his character, his ability is what causes us to believe. And so the people that do not have faith or lack faith, it's because they have not known who God is. And that's something that we are trying to explain yesterday when we read from Genesis 1. So Genesis 1 talks about the works of God, the works of creation, when God spoke and created in the world that we know, as we know it, in 6 days. All everything visible and invisible, including all the micro creature that we cannot see with our eyes, including the thing that we are beyond our ability to recognize. God created them by his mouth. The Bible says his only man, that the Bible says that he took his hands and created him out of the ground, out of the soil of the earth. God created man, male and female. The Bible says he created both. But so we are going to need a lot of faith, especially in 2021, to be able to live in the world that's so changing, even beneath us. We are going to be able to need a tangible faith, an immovable faith that will have no doubt that God is able to do the thing that he promised he is able to do. Because there's a lot of things that are going to cause fear. There's a lot of things that are going to cause a lot of uncertainty. And many people who do not know the Lord will be moved to doubt and to go back to their old ways. And so we really need to move in a direction where we really need to know God on a very intimate level, on a very personal level, with a full revelation of who he is. Otherwise, you know, the Bible says in Daniel, when Daniel 12, but in those days, there will be a lot of evil will increase, and a lot of people, they will grow lukewarm and lose their faith in God. But the Bible says, but the people that know the Lord their God shall be strong, and in those days they shall do exploits. And I believe that those are the very people the Bible talks about in Romans 8, when he says that creation groans as it awaits for the revelation of the sons of God. Those are the people that are going to know God on a very, very personal level, without a shadow of doubt that God is able to do things. He is the only omnipotent God. So today I was actually reading in the book of Job, an unfamiliar book, Job 38. And here is a chapter where God finally speaks up. He speaks in verse 1. But he wasn't speaking to Job. He was speaking to the devil, where the Bible says, and the devil is roaming around the world. And God spoke to him and said, have you seen, have you noticed my servant Job? And the devil said, he only worships you because you have given him so much. You are protecting him. He lacks nothing. That's why he worships you. And the Bible says the Lord gave the devil permission to touch his property, to touch his family, but also his life, his body. And you know the story of Job, and his friends came and they started pinning Job down. One of the things they were pinning him for was, you know what? A man cannot suffer and lose like you've lost unless there is sin in their life. You must have done something very evil to trigger the wrath of God on your life. So you need to repent. So for days, even before they spoke up, they came and looked at Job, and they uttered not a word. But as days went by, they started speaking to him, and Job started responding to him. And in some of his responses, Job was actually doubting and confusing his faith. Finally, in chapter 38 of Job, the Bible talks, the Lord speaks up. Verse 1 says, Then the Lord answered to Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Now prepare yourself like a man. I'll question you and you shall answer me. Verse 4. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have an understanding. Now, yesterday, even science, if you read the earth as a star or a planet, is this huge star, is this huge planet that is carrying 7 billion people, a lot of seas. I mean, if you ever been to, my first time to be at the ocean, it was that it's the Pacific Ocean. I had a chance, an opportunity to go on the Pacific Ocean to go fishing. And I remember my friend, the late a friend of mine, died in a plane crash in Alaska. He took us in his big boat, the biggest boat, a personalized boat that I've ever been on. He took us for a fishing trip. Me and his wife, Pastor Philip, and another young man. So there were about 5 of us on this boat. And the first day, all we did was to sail on that boat for hours and hours. Let me tell you ride on the ocean until you lose sight of the land. And then we got in the middle of the I don't know where we were. We had no contact with the mainland. We did not know how far we had gone. We had no cell phone cover in that area where we ended up. So we just took off and we trusted this guy, the captain, that he knew where he was going and he had been there. We bypassed a lot of fishing boats and we continued on our way. So we only realized after many, many hours when we saw a big ship, like a ship that's bigger than the village of Kawempe, like those huge ship that carries over 3,000 people with a football field on it, with a hotel on it. This thing was huge. And that's when I had a friend say, by the time you get in the path of those big ship on an ocean, you know you are very, very far from the mainland. And let me tell you something. The ocean is big. I cannot even try to describe for you how big the oceans are. The Pacific Ocean. I've never been to the Indian Ocean, but maybe some of you have been to the ocean. But even the lake, our lakes here, Lake Victoria, that's a huge lake, one of the biggest. I think Lake Victoria is said to be the second largest lake in the world, beside Lake Superior. I've been to Lake Superior, somewhere in the middle of the US. Those are big lakes. Let me tell you, Lake Victoria is big. If you try to cross that lake, it will take you several hours. And so going to that ocean, to a fishing trip in the Pacific Ocean, I remember it took us just a full day to get to a place. And then when we got lost and the sun set, and what we did, we threw the anchor and we went to bed in the middle of the night. Annie, it's all about that. I have a neighbor here. So we slept and we woke up. So we were told that if you wake up by 5 in the morning, the fish, you'll be able to fish and get a good catch. So we woke up around 5 and we went fishing. I woke up late and my friends were already making a lot of noise for me. So we went fishing and we caught a lot of fish in that ocean. And I remember coming back. It also took another day from where we fished to back to the mainland. So when the Bible says that, where you, when I lay the foundations of the earth has a foundation. I didn't know that until you read your Bible. Annie, until you read your Bible, you can't leave it. Excuse me for a moment, guys. Where you, when I lay the foundations of the earth, not just a foundation, but foundations. The earth has foundations. And it's amazing when you study, I don't know what they call it, there's a subject actually you study in universities, and some people specialize in, you know, you study about the rocks underneath us, you study about the types of soil, and you study about this foundation. The Bible says God laid them. Tell me if you have understanding. Verse 5 says, who determined its measurement? God measured everything he did. He did not just say by chance or do things by chance. He was measuring, he was taking care of every detail. Surely you know, who stretched the line upon it? To what? Where it is foundation fastened? Or who laid its cornerstone? Verse 7, when the morning star sang together, and all the sons of men shouted for joy. Oh, who shut in the sea with doors? Who shut in the sea with doors when it burst forth and issued from the womb? When I made the cloud its garment, and the thick darkness its swaddling band, when I fixed my limit for it, and set bars and doors, when I laid this far, you may be, when I said, this far you may come, but not farther. And here your proud waves must stop. Have you commanded the morning since your day began, and called the dawn to know its place, that it might take hold of the ends of the earth, and the wicked be shaken out of it? It takes on form like a clay under the seal, and it stands out like a garment. From the wicked their light is withheld, and the unpraised arm is broken. Have you entered the springs of the sea? Now this one blew me away, that even the sea has springs. Have you, verse 16, have you entered the springs of the sea, or have you walked in the search of the depth? Have the gates of death been revealed to you? Or have you seen the doors of the shadow of death? Have you comprehended the breadth of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. Where is the way to the dwelling of light and darkness? Where it is this place that you may take it to his territory, that you may know the path to his home. Do you know it because you were born then, or because the number of your days is great? Have you entered the treasury of snow, or have you seen the treasure of hail, which I have reserved for the time of trouble, for the day of battle and war, by what is light diffused, or the east wind scattered over the earth? Who has divided the channel, a channel for the overflowing water, or a path for the thunderbolt, to cause it to rain on the land where there is no one, a wilderness in which there is no man, to satisfy the desolate waste, and cause to spring forth the growth of the tender grass? Has the rain a father, or who has begotten the drops of dew? From whose womb comes the ice and the frost of heaven? Who gives it birth? The water hardens like stone, and the surface of the deep is frozen. Can you bind the crust of Pleiades, or lose the belt of Orions? Can you bring out Matholoth in its season, or can you guide the great bear with its cubs? Do you know the ordinance of the heavens? Can you set their dominion over the earth? Can you lift up your voice to the crowds, that an abundance of water may cover you? Can you send out lightning, that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the wind? Who has given understanding to the heart? Who can number the crowds by wisdom? Who can pour out the bottles of heaven? When the dust harden in the cramps and the crowds cring together, can you hunt the prey for the lion, or satisfy the appetite of the young lions? When they crouch in their dens, or lack in their lairs to lie in wait, who provide food for the ravens, when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food? Now, all these questions, God is directing them to Job. And they are all hard questions, like God telling, is asking questions, but also passing on information to Job, that it's I, the Lord God, the maker of heaven, that does all these things, measures, has a store for snow and hailstone, and he has purposely kept them for a time of, for the wicked, for battle, and for war. Who ever knew that it is a store for all those? But God designed all these things. And so it brings us to the same question we had yesterday. What kind of God are we talking about? I mean, we are only talking about the earth where he created and put us to live. But even within the earth and its makeup and all the its setup, it's hard to understand. Everything we need to know about the earth that God created, we have to go to school for years. But what kind of God that even measured the foundation of the earth and put the waters where they should be and put doors? He measured, he has lines, he did measurements for the sea, he did measurements for the land, and yet he cares enough to feed the young lions, even the ravens of the air, is able to take care of. And so God is a great God. And that's where our faith needs to be based, that God is so greater than anything you can ever know. He's so bigger than anything we can ever think. God is so big that our faith should be up in the sky. When it comes to believe, we should be people of faith, believing in this amazing, powerful, omnipotent, omniscience God that's so big that the ocean that we fear to cross, he measured them. The seas all put together, the Bible says they're only a drop in the bucket for him. He put doors for them and shut them up. He told them where to go and never go further than where he said. This God is so powerful. This God is unexplainable, is incomprehensible, that we are going to be able, we are going to take eternity to get to try to know him, But it doesn't matter how many millions of years we will be in his presence, even in heaven, on a daily basis, we will always be amazed at his majesty and his greatness. And that's why the angels can only sing one word, "Holy is the Lord." It is so powerful that when you think of your faith and the thing that you believe God for, we need to revise our faith. We really need to repent of the way we perceive God and who he is to us. Because a lot of people, what we have is just a picture of something smaller than God is. It's not, what we've painted in our head is something very, very tiny. But God is a great God. And that's our faith should be rooted in that God created the heavens and he created the earth. And he don't only create the earth by speaking. Even in his speech, he was also working on the details of how this earth should be set up. He founded it on the rocks. There are bigger rocks there underneath the earth. There is a fire. That's why you have volcanoes all over the place. Almost every continent has a few volcanic mountains. And you wonder, where does fire come from? There is a fire, a lot of heat and a lot of fire underneath where we stand on the earth. It's so amazing that the rain comes from up, and it's God who commands the rain to the crowds to drop the rain where we live. And you wonder, when the rains come and you see all this water we call mokoka, running water, dirty going through the swamps, dirty going through the places where people dwell, because people have purposely decided to destroy creation that God created so perfect by making it like a sewer, a sewage place. Everywhere you go, it doesn't matter where you go. If you go in a jungle, like if you ever go on a safari, you can easily tell that you are actually going far away from human beings by seeing less garbage. You can only tell that you are approaching a community of human beings when you see garbage, broken stuff, cut down forest. God created, one of the sins that humans have done is the destruction of creation. Swamps, forest, lakes, it's a sin that God counts against humanity, and we need to repent of it. You should never be, if you are born again, you should never be among people who build their homes in the swamp. You should never be among people who destroy forests, because God created them all and said it was good. For anything that God said it is good, no man should be able to destroy, but honor to enhance and make it even more beautiful. So it is a sin to destroy creation, anything created by God. And so God commands the rain to come down. And when that running water go underneath the ground, God has put a purification system so perfect that if you dig 100 feet underneath where you stand, you will find pure water that you only need to pick and drink. That's how God created the world, so perfect, so beautiful for us to enjoy. So this God that we are talking about is so powerful. He is so powerful, he can do anything. But what amazes me about this powerful God is the kind of love that he has for us, his children, for humanity. God is love. And how powerful as he is, I mean, he can destroy, with all the wickedness going on right now in the world, God had the ability to destroy just this one planet and go maybe two other planets, and he created another perfect earth. But because of love, because he's a God of mercy, he's a God of grace, he's a God of love, he's full of kindness, he will not destroy the people if they are willing to repent. He's so powerful that he can leave, destroy this planet, this earth, and go to another one among the billion stars that he created and put life on another star. But as far as astronomy goes, this is the only planet where life is found. So far as the scientists go on to search for more sciences on all the other orbits and all the other galaxies, life is only found on this one planet called the Earth. So you wonder, why wouldn't God destroy all the people that are so wicked and just go and plant life on another planet? It is because of love. It is because God is love. He loved. When he created man, he created him out of love. And he's not about to destroy man. So his loving kindness is so patient that he's waiting for us, all of us, all of the people to repent. That's why church, we really need to be people that preach the gospel to people that we meet on a daily basis. We need to be people that share Jesus, because it is the love of God. It's the mercy of God that sustains us on a daily basis. So I just wanted to challenge you this week that even as we end 2020 and we go in 2021, you should not be shaken by the things that are going to happen in 2021. I know there will be a lot of things that are scaling, uncertainty, a lot of things that might shake the world. But let me tell you something. The creator of the universe is bigger than his creation. God is bigger than the earth. God is bigger than all creation. God created everything. And you and I belong to him. He calls us his own. He says as we are the apple of his eye. He called us as the chick, as a hen gathers her chicks. So the Lord gathers those who fear his name. And he promises that if you call for me in times of trouble, I will answer you. I will keep you in perfect peace. If you hide under my name, you should be safe even during the times of trouble. There is a promise. We hide under big God. He's able to shield us from sickness, from poverty, from death, from all kinds of calamities. Let me tell you something. If you trust in the Lord your God, even if it is fire that he has let you to go through, still God is able to stop the fire from harming you. We have examples in the book of Daniel. We have examples in the book of Exodus. The children of Israel crossing the Red Sea. God would have made them walk over the water. He could have made them fly over the water, but he just decided that he's going to part the Red Sea so they can walk on dry land. And remember, he just held back the water on both sides so that the children of Israel will not be drawn in the water. Can you imagine walking through a wall of water that has no glass, that has nothing but the hand of God holding it back? That's how powerful God is. He's able to take you through a Red Sea. He's able to take you through the burning furnace. He's able to take you through anything. He's able to save you. He's able to do anything. You need to have trust and faith in God that whatever he said, he had the power to do, because he's bigger than his creation. So, as I said yesterday, we do not need to be people that depend on prayer, that we kind of get this spiritual pride that, oh, I prayed. I know a lot of people, I know a lot, even including pastors, who brag about their prayer life and say, oh, for me when I pray, oh, for me when I start fasting, oh, when I start doing this. Let me tell you something. The greatness of God, the little bit of the revelation that I've got from about the greatness of God has made me so humble that brought me to a place of humility that I do not even talk about how much I pray. Of course, I need to be praying, but I understand that my prayer life is nothing compared to His greatness. It is His grace that enables me to pray. It is His grace that enables me to fast. It is His grace that enables me to read my Bible. It is not my power. It's not by power. It's not by mighty, but by the Spirit of God. For everything we see and we do, we are saved by grace. We walk by grace. We stand by grace. We minister by grace. We do all we do by grace. Even prayer is the grace of God that enables us. Even when you walk, it is the grace of God that's enabling you to walk. There is nothing in a human that you can do on your own without the grace of God. So anything that you do, you need to understand it is God who sustains you in everything. Not your wisdom, not your power, not your might, but the grace of God. It is what enables us. And so we should be people who confidently walk in life with this confidence that we have a Father in heaven. He is also the creator of the heavens and the earth. And He is able. There's nothing too hard for the Lord. He is so big that by His mouth, He created everything we see. He is so big that He commanded things to be. He is so big that He measured the seas and He measured the waters. He commanded the firmament. He commanded the sun to stand still. He commanded the moon to position itself for light. He commands everything in creation to do whatever He wishes. Where He told the sea to stop, the sea will never cross. Where he told the river to stop, the river will never go beyond its boundaries. It is because the Lord God is so powerful that even the oceans obeys Him. Even the seas. You remember when Jesus was in the boat and He was resting and there was a storm on the sea. And Peter and his friends woke Him up and say, "Lord, Lord, don't you care that we are drowning and we are perishing?" And Jesus woke up, straightened His hand and He said, "Peace." And immediately the Bible says the sea was calm. And the disciples were wondering, what kind of man is this that even the storms obey Him? Of course, they missed the point. He's the creator. He actually commanded the sea to bring the storms. And then He told them how far they should go. He even fashioned their forms and their sizes. When you go on the lake or on any water body, you realize that even the waves moves and their move is beautiful. They come in such a way that they are like someone has commanded them to come. So beautiful and so gracious. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to assure you that you are in safe hands. I don't know what you are believing God for. I don't know what you need to believe God for. I don't know what God has commanded you and is speaking to you to do. But you need to get rid of fear and embrace faith, believing that He who speaks to you or who commands you to do, He is not even leaving you to do it on your own. He's enabling you, whatever He says you to do. He's also standing behind you and telling you, "I'm going to do it through you." If God commands you to do something, He's not leaving you on your own. He's actually enabling you. He's also pushing you by grace to do that. So it is God at work in us and through us. So we never have to fear any situation. We never have to fear anything. Our only concern should be, has God spoken to me? Has God told you to do that? Is it God leading you? I mean, that's your biggest worry. That's why you really need to pray and spend time in prayer asking God. It's called inquiring of the Lord. Inquiring of the Lord we see it. David did it several times during his lifetime. That David will inquire of the Lord, and he will inquire and say, "Should I follow them? Should I pursue my enemies?" And the Lord will say, "Pursue them." And with that assurance, David will go after his enemies with this confidence. And so Israel feared David, and they said he was a fierce fighter. Why? David knew the Lord, that God is so big, he cannot even lie. He's so big, he can change his mind. He's so great and so pure that whatever he says, he will do. Oh my God, I'm excited for the future. We are about to see things that we've been promised, the exchange of wealth. The wealth is about to come in our hands. We are about to own the thing that the world has held from us for too long. And we are about to lead. We are about to be influencers over our politicians. We are about to influence nations. We may not necessarily need to even to occupy positions, but we are going to influence economies. We are going to influence missions. We are going to influence the way things are done all over the world. Why? Because God is choosing us as a church to be his vessel to use. And it's going to be him at work in us and through us. So that's my challenge to you. What are you believing God for? And why are you fearing? What has God spoken to you to do? Is it to give something? Is it to start a ministry? Is it to join something? Is it to go back to school? And now you are worried that God who spoke to you is not able to give you the 5 million that you need, or is not able to provide for the thing that he says you should be doing. Come on. We need to revise our faith. Our faith should not be based on who we are, but on who God is. And I have told you, God spoke to Job and said, "Where were you when I laid the foundation of the world? Were you there when I made the line? Do you know its measurement? Do you know even where the sea stops? Were you there when I commanded it that this is how far you should go?" That's the God that we serve. And that's the confidence we should have. Church, 2021 is going to be an amazing year. Why? Because God, the God of heaven, is on our side, and we are going to work with him, and he's going to work in us and through us, and he's going to use us. Some of you don't even understand yourself. In the next 5 years, God is going to do so much with you that your family will forget who you are and call you by another name. So I want to stop here and open up our lines so we can use the last 10 minutes to pray. And if you need to repent, go ahead. You need to repent that you've ignored, you've doubted, you've moved in unbelief, you've gone in sleepless nights, you've not eaten, you prayed out of fear, and instead of confidence, you feared more than you have believed. Let's open up our lines. Please unmute your mic. Let's go before the Lord in prayer, every one of us. Let's